What's going on, everybody? Welcome back to the Illinois Tech Dynasty and the Season 4 off-season video is part 1. We always do a part 2 and part 1 in this series, but we are hopping into Season 5 of the series after a very fun 13-1 season. We won our division, we won our conference, we beat Miami in the Fiesta Bowl. It was a pretty fun year, and of course, sending off this senior class the way that we wanted to send them off with the biggest game in program history being that Fiesta Bowl. Kevin Fields led the offense through the air this year. The freshman quarterback from Plant City, Florida, threw 33 touchdowns, 12 interceptions, and 3,500, almost 3,600 yards. 255 a game, throwing 82%, and only sacked 21 times, which is a series low. The offensive line getting better each year. Kind of concerned as to where this offense is going to be next year without their star running back Anthony Bishop, who ran for almost 1,700 yards this year on nearly 300 attempts, 24 touchdowns, averaging over 5 yards a carry, nearly 120 per game. Yards after contact is pretty impressive, 7 carries of 20 plus yards. I mean, the kid's the total package going forward. Surprisingly, the second leading rusher on the team was our quarterback, then Andre Hayford, who's probably going to be the starter for next season, and then O'Brien with 187 on the ground and 2 touchdowns. Through the air, I'm happy to say we have our first 1,000-yard receiver in team history, Eric Torrios, the junior from Columbus, Ohio, 72 receptions, 1,000, almost 1,100 yards, 13 touchdowns. Pretty hefty amount of those yards were after the catch, and no drops for Torrios this year, which is pretty impressive with 72 grabs. Opposite of him is another near 1,000-yard receiver, Marcus O'Brien, the freshman, 919 with 60 grabs and 5 scores. T.C. Shelton, the senior, who's unfortunately leaving at 6 touchdowns this year. Fred Edwards finding a role with the offense. He came in big during that Fiesta Bowl with that big-time touchdown that really put the game away. And then Anthony Bishop, 30 grabs and 3 scores this season. Brent Brown, likely to be the slot receiver for the team this year, taking Shelton's spot, had 16 grabs for 219 and 1 score. Heading into the year, this offensive line was definitely one of the bigger questions with a heavy mix of either true freshmen or redshirt freshmen. Corbett, of course, being a junior and Gardner being a transferred sophomore, the line held up well. You know, only 21 sacks on Kevin Fields this year is pretty impressive. On to the defense, led by the freshman linebacker Tiger Anderson, led the way in tackles. Corbin led the way with tackles for a loss with 25, and also led the team and the country with sacks, as we will see in a second. 19 this year. Kind of wish he stayed a little more consistent throughout the entire year. It seemed like a lot of those came early, and he was kind of unproductive towards the second half of the year. Dwyer leading in interceptions, also led in pass deflections. We should have had a lot more picks this year. Two hands on the football, you should be able to bring it in, and unfortunately these guys were dropping picks left and right. Onto fumble, forced, and recovered. Obviously this number is not where I want it to be, but we've got to tackle better to begin with. You know, forcing fumbles comes later. Only one safety this year from Jack Cobbs, and defensive touchdowns, 4 on the team. 2 from Hicks, of course, 1 coming in the Fiesta Bowl, the big time score to get things going. Moving on to kicking, Zach Carroll, 12 of 14 for 85%. Longest kick this year was 44 yards, 71 of 71 on extra points. Inside of 30, perfect. From 30 to 39, perfect. From 40 to 49, he's perfect. But from outside of 50, he missed 2. And on kickoffs, 93 kickoffs this season and 48 touchbacks. Not bad. Corey Perkins, our freshman punter, literally the most underutilized position on our team right now. 12 punts, 500 yards, 35 net. It's not great. It's not bad. On returns, this is where things, I think, got really big for Bishop. You look at total yardage for him, 1,100 yards coming from returns, plus the yards he had on the ground, that probably got him the Heisman. Moving on to the league leaders, Kevin Fields leading in QBR, but Sawyer Smith of Troy leading in pass yards this year. John Urzua from Mid-Tennessee State leading in passing touchdowns. Of course, we picked him off his first pass attempt of week 1. Jawan Pass of Louisville and Mitchell Skeen of Washington lead in interceptions. And Mitch, if you're still watching this, you are doing all right in Washington. It's not great, but you've got a lot of work to do. Yards per game leader, Sawyer Smith. Passing percentage leader is, of course, Kevin Fields, 82%, even with the QB accuracy at 5. We're still finding ways to get things done. Longest pass to Montez of Colorado. And most sacked quarterback, Evan Sharefs. Moving on to the rush leaders this year, Freddie Holly from Hawaii, 376 carries for 2,200 yards, average a little under 6 yards a carry there, but Bishop leading in touchdowns on the year with 24. Kelton Moore and Holly right behind him at 20 apiece. Longest run this year goes to pocket passer Malik Mitchell of Western Michigan, and your yards per game leader, Freddie Holly, 159 a game, Bishop at 119. Yards after contact, Bishop leads the nation 393 and rushes of more than 20 yards. Bishop with 7 leading everyone. And your rush fumble leader this year, Harold Miller, quarterback I was looking at a couple years ago to bring in. Unfortunately, that did not fall through. Reception leader, Lorenzo Sellers of Central Michigan. And your yardage leader, Darian Landry. As we very well know from seasons 1 and 2, there is no defense played in the MAC conference. Courtney Davis of Texas A&M leading in touchdowns with 17, and Landry just under 100 yards receiving per game. Yak leader this year, DeAndre Overton, 6'5", 204 receiver from Clemson, and your drop pass leader, Justin Lane of Eastern Michigan. Scott Topol from NIU giving him 19 sacks this year. Moving on to the defense, Jaquan Ulee of Marshall with the most tackles this year, but Anderson leading in solo tackles with 80 this season. Tackles for a loss, Tippa Gallier from TCU had 32, and Thomas Corbin leading the country in sacks by a long shot with 19. Gallier in second with 13.5, Mackey with 9 a little further down the board. Dane Jackson of Pitt, your Thorpe winner, 10 interceptions. It really annoys me that we could have had guys further up on this list, but people don't want to catch passes. KJ Gray with 21 pass deflections, not bad for the junior. I don't think we're ever going to see a blocked kick or a blocked punt, but there are other teams getting those things done. And your safety leader, technically Jack Cobb's tied for first with one on the year. Kicking this year, your field goal leader as far as made kicks go, Brandon Mann. And your field goal percentage leader is Austin Johnson, the Groza winner this season. Longest field goal kick goes to Justin Cook, the junior kicker from Memphis. And your extra point leader, surprisingly, someone scored more touchdowns than us this season. That is Clemson. Leader as far as punt attempt goes, and this is not a good stat, as Jimmy Means from Washington State. Jonathan Femi-Cole, your kick return yardage leader, and Demarie Crockett with 2 kick returns this season leads the nation. Punt return yard leader, the freshman running back Dan Brown, who I think I was going after last season as well. Adrian Killis leads in punt return touchdowns. Moving on to career numbers, it is the end of the line in college for Anthony Bishop. What a career. 1,000 total carries, 6,326 yards, 66 touchdowns, 12 broken tackles. Obviously, that number should be higher, but this game doesn't calculate those very well. Only 4 rushing fumbles through the air, nearly 1,000 yards over his career, 10 touchdowns. Not a bad stat line for Bishop, plus the awards he hauled in. And I'm pretty sure he won the Heisman this year based on his return numbers helping his rushing and receiving numbers. CC Shelton, one of the original freshmen for this program, unfortunately is also out the door. Solid numbers that have kind of fluctuated year after year, but he's been very productive. Eric Torrijos, our number one receiver this year, and his production just continues to improve. Unfortunately, entering his final year with the team with Fred Edwards, who was also a part of that original freshman class or the first recruiting class we had, he's found a role with the offense. Thomas Corbin's production through his entire career has been pretty solid outside of this incredible leap in numbers for the Saxon. Hopefully Corbin makes it onto a roster on the next level. He is a bit undersized. We'll see what happens with him. Jamal Dwyer is also entering his senior year with Edwards and Torrijos, a member of that first recruiting class, and his numbers have gotten better, although he's still kind of a work in progress. And David Davis, kind of the same thing. I mean, they're around the same overall. They both play well most times. We'll see what happens this year for them. Quentin McKenzie also entering his senior year. The numbers are kind of around the same as they've been the past 3 years. I honestly don't know if he's going to be starting this season or his upcoming year. And then DeAndre Mackey, solid production. He's got 2 years left. And of course, there's Nate Taylor, who led this team when Kelly went down last season. I love Nate Taylor. Thank you for being a part of this team for that short period of time. Moving on to the All-Americans, Anthony Bishop, first team All-NCAA. He made it along with Thomas Corbin, along with DeAndre Mackey, along with Tiger Anderson and Ricky Hodges. And we're not done there. Victor Hicks, Jack Cobbs also make All-NCAA first team. This team is looking very good going forward. John Urzua makes All-NCAA second team, so Kevin Fields, despite his pretty good year, did not make second team. So far, no members of the Wolfpack defense kind of flying through here until we get to the safeties. And there is Noah Harrell, who had two interceptions, I believe, this year. Not a ton of production from him. I'm not sure how he made All-NCAA second team. Moving on to the All-NCAA freshman list. Kevin Fields, Marcus O'Brien also makes the All-American list this year. David James, Shedrick Richardson, Travis Richardson. Not a bad year for a lot of these freshmen. Moving down the list, Anderson makes the list. Bernard, Pete Davis on the board for the Wolfpack. Victor Hicks makes the list. I'm not upset with this. Not bad at all. Moving on to the All-American first team. Keen makes first team ahead of Kevin Fields. Bishop makes first team. Chris Barr, Eric Torrios makes the All-American first team. Thomas Corbin, DeAndre Mackey, Patrick Hawkins makes first team. Anderson, Hodges, Dwyer makes first team. Hicks, Cobbs, Zach Carroll makes first team as well. And then there's Demarie Crockett, second team. All-American Kevin Fields, I feel like he got snubbed. Elijah Mack makes second team. Marcus O'Brien makes second team. There's David James at center. I'm actually kind of surprised that Kendall Gardner did not make at least second team in conference. McKenzie makes the list as the second right end. There's David Davis as the top corner. Noah Harrell again, not sure how he made the list, but he did. On to school records as Kevin Fields has set the bar for touchdowns and passing yards in a season. Torrios sets the bar for receiving touchdowns in a year with 13. A lot of those records could maybe be broken by Torrios this year. He's got 1 year to get things done. Thomas Corbin setting the bar pretty high for pretty much any defensive lineman or linebacker we have that's going to be going to the quarterback. Those sack numbers are incredible. On the ground, Anthony Bishop is really going to be missed. These numbers are incredible. The only records we didn't break were touchdowns in a game. I think he tied four when we played Navy in season one. That yardage number was not being broken. QBR leader, new record. Kevin Fields at nearly 200. On to the team stats. Illinois Tech this year, 7,586 total yards. Little under 6,000 on offense, 3,596 through the air, 2,354 on the ground, 39 points per game, 33 passing touchdowns, and 36 rushing. Your total yards leader this year, the Georgia Bulldogs, 8,254, and your worst in total yards is the Colorado State Rams at 4-7 this year. Offensive yards leader, Georgia, the Bulldogs, 68-88. And there's 2-8 Tulsa, 0-8 in conference. They've got a lot of work to do. That's pretty pathetic. Passing yards leader, Mid-Tennessee State, Troy, then South Florida. And the worst, Air Force, UConn, Navy, New Mexico, very option-heavy teams. Navy, your top rush offense, Ohio State in second, Georgia Tech in third. Where do the Buckeyes come from? Washington State, your worst run team. Points per game leader, Clemson, 43.5. Troy with 39.8. They just barely edge out Illinois Tech. Your top pass touchdown leader, that's Rice with 41 this season. And the worst, Tulsa, only 8 this year? Why even have a quarterback? That's pretty bad. And here's your rushing touchdown leader, Navy with 51, Wolfpack with 36, a little down the board. Somehow, even with a majority underclassmen team, this defense found a way to top the numbers from last year. We're definitely near the bottom of the board when it comes to offensive yards allowed. South Carolina, the best defense in that regard, and Syracuse, the worst. 1-11 year for the Orange, not very good. Don't ask me how, but somehow Air Force has the best pass defense in the nation, and the Minnesota Golden Gophers, the worst. No, but seriously, how did Air Force only give up 1,700 yards through the air this year? Your best run defense, however, is Illinois Tech Miami in second, and your worst run defense, Fresno State, 3,100 yards given up on the ground. Best defense as far as points allowed goes, that is Oklahoma State Wolfpack, 3 points behind them at 243, and Missouri your worst with nearly 500. I remember those days when we were giving up 500 points in a year. Bad times. Sack leader, Illinois Tech, worst sack team, Colorado only 15. Miami, the Hurricanes, leading in fumbles recovered this year, and your interception leader, Pittsburgh, with 25, Illinois Tech with 17. We are improving. Conversions, Illinois Tech this year was 79 of 120 on third downs, that's 65%, 8 of 10 on fourth downs, and 0 for 1 on two-point tries. Do we need two-point tries? No. But 65% will lead the country, Navy at 61, Purdue at 60, right behind us. And your worst third down team, Washington State, 34. That's not very good at all. Taking a look at Illinois Tech in the red zone on offense, 67 attempts, 51 touchdowns, 10 field goals for 91%. And on defense, 43 trips allowed, giving up 23 touchdowns and 5 field goals for 65%. The team with the most trips to the red zone this year, 81 attempts for Hawaii, but only 77% of those trips ended up in points, so obviously not very good. Clemson leading in touchdowns in the red zone with 58, and your percentage leader is Air Force at 92, Illinois Tech just slightly off at 91. Not bad, though. And despite how good their defense is with the interceptions, Pittsburgh's offense must be throwing picks of their own. Defensive trips allowed, the most allowed this year goes to Miami University in Ohio, and the best team in the red zone as far as trips allowed goes, that is your Washington Huskies. Most touchdowns given up is Kansas State, the least Oklahoma State, Georgia, Washington, then Illinois Tech. And your best team as far as percentage goes in the red zone, only allowing 28 of 43 attempts to score. And the worst defense in the red zone is Memphis, 95%. We finally finished with a positive turnover differential. I cannot tell you how stressful this year has been. Every now and again, I make a mistake, but for the most part, Kevin Fields was on the money. Can't wait for next year as we look to maybe top Miami as they were plus 16. For some reason, I didn't check the team with the most giveaways, but your team with the most takeaways is Pittsburgh with 31, 25 picks to 6 fumble recoveries. So let's move on to the coaching carousel. Coach Chris Hall staying with the Wolfpack through 2022 at least, and looking at teams hiring. Brian Kelly fired from Notre Dame, and our former defensive coordinator Craig Munoz, one of the top candidates to take the job, and Les Miles retiring at 66. Munoz also rumored to be in the running for that LSU job. That would be pretty big. So let's move on to the next week of the offseason and look at some of the players that are leaving. For the first time, someone's transferring away. Javon Bracken, who we just brought in, he's homesick. He wants to go back to Louisiana, and he's going to go to Tulane, who's a conference opponent. He might start next year with his training bonuses, so we'll see what happens with Bracken. But outside of him, everyone else is a senior, and everyone is graduating, so not bad. No juniors leaving early. That's good news. On to coach changes, and as you can see at the bottom of the screen, we unfortunately have lost our coordinators again, and our new defensive coordinator is Brian Kelly. Bob Diaco leaves for a new position, so does Jay Hobson, and we're getting Brian Kelly and Doc Holliday, and who knows how long they're going to be here. Holliday is the former head coach at Western Michigan, and he was fired. So we keep bringing in these rejects, of course. Brian Kelly was fired from Notre Dame. Diaco taking the head coaching job at Central Michigan. And it looks like Jay Hobson's moving on to Iowa State to be their new head coach. Craig Munoz has taken the job at LSU to replace Les Miles. I want to play LSU this year. I want this storyline to continue. So on to transfer request. Illinois Tech, nothing. We've never had a transfer come in, which is okay with me because they normally end up being bad players. But on to draft results. The time is here. Bishop, Corbin, were not drafted. Somehow Nate Taylor was picked in the 7th round instead of our two star players. This game doesn't make any sense. Taylor didn't even play this year outside of that one carry in the Fiesta Bowl for 12 yards. I don't even understand how this happened. This doesn't make any sense. Are you seriously trying to tell me that Bishop and Corbin couldn't have at least been seventh round picks? Obviously, we're not going off of that for any future references. On to recruiting and recapping what we've done so far. The only sub we brought in this year was Justin Graydon. Jeremiah Lowry, the five-star recruit, 94 speed, 92 agility, 92 acceleration, is probably going to play safety with that tackling rating, although he won't be playing this year. Jordan Keller, the top receiver in this class, along with Drew Edwards, the number three receiver in this class. These guys are definitely going to be redshirting this year. Paul Moore, the four-star, 5'9", 173 corner, a lot of speed, great coverage. Don't know if he's going to play this year. Probably not. Eric McLaughlin might play this year. And Chris Scott is going to redshirt for sure this year at defensive end. On to the final few players remaining on the board. We've got 1,300 points to use and not many players I want. Richard Carpenter, the number one back in the country. A lot of speed, but also some fumbling issues at 63 carrying. It's not very good. Lance Wilcox at tight end. I feel is a pretty similar player to Fred Edwards, 72 overall, 82 speed, decent strength, good hands, just can't block great right now, but that could be worked on. Johnny Ingram at guard. We are not really dying for an offensive lineman right now, but 86 strength and 92 excel with 69 speed is not the worst thing in the world. He can obviously develop. At defensive tackle, Anthony Carter from Oklahoma. We currently have the lead on him from Georgia. He's not very fast. He's not overly strong, doesn't get off blocks perfectly, but he's decent. And then Ryan Robbins from Arizona, coverage linebacker. Man coverage isn't great. Zone coverage is okay. He's got decent speed, but I have linebackers I like right now. So what we're going to do is focus on Carpenter, and we're going to focus on Carter and get these guys on the roster. We don't have a ton of wiggle room with our roster right now. We're kind of near the cap for players you can have. And as we move into team news, we got Carpenter, we got Carter, and for some reason we also got Ingram. I never offered a scholarship. I never put points in him, so I don't know how that happened. But we have the top class in the conference, a top 10 class, despite not having very many people. We got another five-star top 10 prospect. Of course, the subs that were on the board this year that we couldn't bring in, Trenton Seibel to Wisconsin, Jacoby Rush to Wisconsin as well, both tight ends going to the Badgers, Luke Dawn to Western Michigan. I believe we covered most of these names earlier in the season. Abraham Charles from San Diego, California, heading to Arizona to play with the Wildcats. And of course, we got Justin Graydon coming here. Number 9 class in the country, 5 5 stars, 2 4 stars, 4 3 stars, and 6 2 stars. And obviously, most of those guys will be cut. On to position changes, not much changing here, as I will be moving Jason Hicks over to left end to take Corbin's place. He was playing a right end last year. Curtis Goodman and Anderson are going to switch on the actual roster. On the depth chart, I have them switched. I like Anderson playing on the right side of our defense. And then Jeremiah Lowry, the athlete, is going to play, or at least redshirt this year, at safety, strong safety. And we'll see where things go from there. Cobbs and Harrell will be seniors next year. So after they leave, it'll be down to Mike Smith and Jeremiah Lowry. So let's look at those training results. And your top overall player for the second year in a row, I believe, is Eric Torrijos at 95 overall. A little faster, a little stronger. Kevin Fields, 94. Didn't get a bump in speed. McKenzie is the third highest. Carroll's at 90 as well. And then on to custom conferences. And of course, a lot of people want to see us move to the Big Ten Conference, play teams like Illinois and Northwestern every year, Ohio State, Penn State, Michigan State. Unfortunately, we're not moving to the Big Ten this year. We're spending one final season in the American Conference. I told myself I wanted two conference championships or two big-time bowl games to have us move to the Big Ten Conference. And now into the new season, 2017 preseason. It's time to get going. And we're going to start things by talking about our schedule. For some reason, despite us winning the Fiesta Bowl and most of our players returning and having a great recruiting class, we still are not ranked. So my plans to have a neutral site game to begin the year is not going to happen. I do want to play Georgia Tech. Craig Munoz took the job at LSU. I do want to play the Tigers at some point. That leaves two other non-conference games between weeks 3, 4, 5, and week 14. Non-conference is pretty big this year as the conference opponents are pretty much the same as last year. Tulane, East Carolina, UConn, Memphis. That same stretch of Houston, SMU, and Navy back-to-back-to-back, and then Tulsa. I think I can reshuffle the conference schedule, I believe. I'm not 100% sure. If I can, I will, because that stretch of three games back-to-back-to-back is going on for 2 years in a row, and that's not something I'm looking forward to, although those games are going to be great. And that, everybody, is going to do it for this year's offseason. There will be a part two to the offseason where we go through the roster. It's going to be a pretty decently lengthy video. We're going to go through the entire roster. We're going to go through starters, backups, even players that are going to be redshirting for sure this year. A lot of the receivers we brought in are very exciting players. I've already messed around with this a little bit. A lot of the new guys, especially these receivers, crazy good. And we've got a lot of receivers that redshirted last year. They're going to keep these guys off the field. So we'll see what happens. I know a lot of people want to talk recruiting, sub-recruiting for this year. That right now is something I'm not ready to talk about. I will talk about that in the next off-season video. But thank you all for tuning in. Hope you guys enjoyed season 4. Took a little longer than normal, but season 4 ended right on time, as later today, something special is happening. See you guys then. Thanks for watching.